Should kids be using their fingers in math class? I'm getting ready to do some webinars all about how kids get stuck in that phase where they're counting on their fingers for addition and counting through skip counting on their fingers for multiplication. Now, every time I do trainings around this idea, I get people who will tag the article by Jo Boaler all about why kids should be using their fingers in math class. Now, I do not disagree with that article, but what I disagree with is people just reading the headline of that article and not digging into the research and what she talks about in that article about how kids are using their fingers. I'm Christina Tonnevold, the recovering traditionalist, and I hope that you will stick around as we investigate helping students use their fingers for math class effectively in our quest to build our math minds so that we can build the math minds of our students. Now, I'm going to start off with what I start off pretty much the basis of all of my videos is the understanding that came through the work of Thomas Carpenter and his colleagues through cognitively guided instruction, also known as CGI. This is a foundational to understand effective use of fingers and ineffective use of fingers. There's definitely a time and place for all of them, but I gotta start out with this progression. So what Thomas Carpenter and his group found is that when we do not teach students how to solve problems, they actually go through these phases. And how they did it was just giving kids problems in context and then watching to see how they solved problems. And as their sense of numbers grew, they would progress through these stages. So the first stage is known as direct modeling. This is where when you give a kid a problem like Johnny has 3 balloons and then he gets 4 more balloons, how many balloons does he have now? They have to model each piece of that problem and then come back and count it all again. So with fingers, it might look like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then they have to come back and recount every single one of those to figure out that it's 7. Now, that is totally fine if that's where the students are at. Okay, that's the phase they're at, then that's what they should be doing. As they start to progress with their understanding of numbers, they get to a phase known as counting, where they will hold one of those numbers in their head and then count on to get to the answer. Typically, they hold the first number because they're modeling that situation. He had 3, and then he got 4 more, so they would count 4 more to do that, to figure out how much it is. Now, the same holds true if you're working with multiplication. Let's say the problem was something like, Sue had 3 bags of cookies. In each bag were 4 cookies. Okay, so 3 times 4 instead of 3 plus 4. A kid who's a direct modeler needs to model those 3 groups, putting 4 in each group, and then they come back and count every single one of those. Okay, in the counting on phase or counting phase, they are basically skip counting. So they don't have to make all 4 of them. They know that there's 4 and a 4 and a 4. So they're counting 4, 8, 12. They skip count along. Now, those, again, these are not bad phases. It is not horrible if your kids are there, if that's where they need to be. The hard part is that we will get 5th graders and even high schoolers who are still counting on their fingers to solve problems like 7 plus 8. There becomes a time when we need to know math quickly. Yes, I want kids to develop their conceptual understanding, but if they are not fast with their facts, it ends up hindering things as they progress through. My end goal is, yes, I want kids to be fluent with their math facts, but fluent doesn't just mean it's memorized. That's not what I'm talking about. There are definitely ones that we have memorized, but the problem is if a kid doesn't have it memorized, what they end up doing is falling all the way back down the progression to that counting phase. So the in-between phase that cognitively guided instruction found was this thing called derived facts. Kids who may not know it instantly, but they know a way to derive it. So in that 3 plus 4, you might hear a kid say something like, well, I know 3 plus 3 is 6 and 1 more makes 7. Okay. If it's the multiplication, it was 3 times 4. A lot of kids might know, well, 2 times 4 is 8. So then just 1 more group of 4 gives me 12. Right? They're using something they know to help them with something they don't know. That phase, derived fact, and then the next phase of just fact, those two are what are often known as fluent. When kids are up in those two phases, they are fluent. So eventually we want to get kids up there to those two phases. But if they're first graders, they may still be directly modeling and counting, and that's okay, that's where they're at, right? But eventually we have to help them start to develop some understanding of numbers that start moving them up this progression. Now, the webinars that I reference, that's what we talk about because it's a whole big topic. It's not something I can do in a short 10, 15 minute video. So if you want to learn more about that, there's links underneath here where you can register for one of those webinars. There's one for pre-K to second grade. We're going to talk about why kids get stuck counting on their fingers. And then third through fifth grade, where we're going to talk about how to move kids past that skip counting phase, right? So, but in today's lesson, we're going to talk about how to help kids effectively use their fingers, okay? And the difference between kids who are counting one by one and kids who are doing something known as subitizing, or also known as finger notia. Now, what in the world is that? All right. Well, those two things are actually what Jo Boaler's talking about in that article. If you go to that article about why kids should use fingers in the math class, and then actually you read it, but then click on the research that is linked in that article. And the research is all about kids who are able to subitize and do finger notia. Now, what is finger notia? But basically, it is a subset of subitizing. That's the way I am taking it from what I have read. Subitizing is when you instantly recognize without having to count. Like when you're doing playing a dice game and you roll it and you see those pip marks on the dice and you just know it's 5. You just subitized. When you're doing something with 10 frames and you see this, do you instantly know how many it is without having to count? That's subitizing. And then when I do something like this, were you able to tell how many? That's subitizing, but it's also known as finger notia. This is known as finger notia. It's being able to recognize the spatial patterns of your fingers to help you know how many without having to count. So to me, it's like a subset of subitizing. And if I'm wrong in my understanding, let me know in the comments. But all of the research that Jo links to is all about kids who are able to subitize and have finger notia. They are performing great in math class. It is not kids who are counting 1 by 1 by 1 by 1 to show you 5. It's the kids who, when you go like this, they know it's 5. That type of understanding of fingers is what's showing that it's predictive of kids' ability to perform better in mathematics. So what does this look like when they're adding? Let's start there. So let's say I have 6 plus 7. The problem was 6 plus 7. It can be in a context, whatever, but I'm just going to say 6 plus 7, right? So if I'm doing 6 plus 7, I could sit there and count out 6 and then count out 7, but I don't have enough fingers to show that, right? So that's why kids will move into that counting phase. We move them into that counting phase because you don't have enough fingers to show it when you get to larger amounts, if you're counting 1 by 1. But if you have finger notia and you have that ability to subitize using your fingers, can you picture 6? Yeah, it looks like this. Can you picture 7? Yeah, like this. Now, put those pictures together. What did you do? Did you count every single one of your fingers? Kids with finger notia don't. They see the groupings. When I see 6 and then I have 7, they will put the fives, the two fives together to make 10, and then they put the two and the one together to make the three, and they combine those to make 13. That is a very powerful derived fact. 6 plus 7 is the same thing as having 5 plus 5 plus a 2 and a 1. That is a huge way to think about those problems. And it's a way that without that visual, without finger notia, becomes very difficult for our kids. That's why kids with finger notia can perform better in mathematics, because they're able to use those visuals and then solve the problem. So if you do read through Jo's work, it's talking about they didn't even use their fingers a lot of times, but when they were thinking about the problem, the brain, the parts of their brain that stimulate the fingers were being used, and they start to visualize that subitizing or finger notia as they're solving problems. Okay, so we want to help kids develop subitizing and finger notia so that they can use those visuals and they're not reliant upon counting one by one by one with their fingers. So finger notia, not just counting one by one by one. Now, what does this look like when it comes to multiplication? All right, so let's do a little bit bigger problem. Last time I said 3 times 4. Let's say the problem was something like Sue had 7 bags of cookies, and in each bag, she had 4 cookies. Now, in this case, the context matters, because when it's like that and it's 7 groups of 4, 7 bags of cookies with 4 in each group, kids need to count. They follow the problem. They're going to count by 4s 7 times. And yes, it would be way easier if they just did 4 times 7 and thought of it about it as 4 groups of 7. It's way less counting, way less addition if they're doing repeated addition. But the problem does not say that. The problem says that they have 7 groups of 4. So guess what they're going to count? 7 groups of 4. And if they're in that skip counting phase, they have to go 4, 8, 12. And then some of them are like, what's 12 plus 4? And they're off to the side counting 1 by 1 by 1, right? Then they get 16, then 20, then 24, then 28. And do they know when to stop? That's the other problem. If they don't have finger notia, they don't know when they've done 7 groups of 4. But if they have finger notia and they think in their mind, okay, I need 7. Now remember, 7 can look like this, 7 can look like this. I don't care if you have 7 like this. You could even have 7 as 4 and 3. That's 7, okay? But typically kids will see 7 as 5 and then some more over here, however they're doing it. But the cool part about it like this is that kids will develop that very powerful derived fact for 7s. 7s suck. 7s, when you're multiplying by 7s, it is not friendly for a lot of our kids. But guess what is friendly? 5s and 2s. 5s and 2s, kids learn quickly when it comes to multiplication. So if what they have in their mind is 7, and then they could think, okay, well, 5 groups of 4 is 20, and 2 groups of 4 is 8, 20 and 8 gives me 28. So they just took that 7 groups of 4 and broke it into 5 groups of 4 and 2 groups of 4, which is an amazing derived fact, but through the use of their fingers. Their fingers help them out. So yes, fingers are very powerful to use in math class, but we've got to help kids use them effectively and help them use those finger patterns to move through the CGI progression. Now, if you want to learn more about how to help your kids move through those progressions, like I said, I've got webinars coming up. The links are below this video or down at the very bottom of the post. There's one that's focused for pre-K to second grade about how to develop these understandings and help kids move past counting on their fingers. And then there's one for 3rd through 5th grade, all focused on how to help build this understanding and help kids move past that skip counting phase. Now, depending upon when you're watching this video, the webinars may be over, but that link might take you to a wait list and you may be able to sign up for the next time that I do the webinar. So I hope that this video has helped you build your math mind so that you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.